So this lecture will be focused more on theory, and also there will be a little bit more of geometry than yesterday, so I hope you'd like it even better. So the focus here is on trying to understand the theoretical guarantee, so the guarantee of performance you can have for a large family of inverse problem regularization methods. Okay, so I will briefly recall, I would say, the setup that I described yesterday, so I will go quite quickly on this, and then I will introduce a few concepts, mostly from convex analysis. So this is really focused on convex geometry, the geometry of convex set, actually. So the message is, if you understand very well the geometry of your regularizer, then you can do a lot of things and understand very well, in detail, its performance. Okay? Okay, so the setup is, we have a linear inverse problem. So the phi matrices, or linear operator here, models the acquisition device. Could think about your digital camera that has some blur. You have missing pixels, so it could be a masking operator. Could be a random projector if you do compress sensing. Very general setup. And also remember that we have a noise, W. So here, W is assumed to be deterministic. So there's no model on it. Just we know roughly what is its magnitude. Okay? And then we design some kind of variational optimization method to try to come up with some x that we hope is close from the unknown x0. Okay? So the x is one of the solutions of this convex minimization scheme. And here we use just plain L2 fidelity, so for sake of simplicity. And of course, what is important is to have a good regularization penalty here. Okay, so there is some lambda that needs to be chosen. I've already spoke a bit about this yesterday. And in the case where there is no noise, what you hope is to find exactly x0. And then you solve this constrained optimization. So once again, there is a typo here. It should be phi. But among all solutions of the linear system, you pick the one that has the smallest j value. Okay, so pretty simple setup. And the question now that we'll address today is about the performance. So how far is the x that you recover from the x0? And of course, to do this, you need some hypothesis on the noise level, probably on x0 itself, so on the geometry of the data, and also to know, of course, what your regularizer is actually doing. Okay? And I've already said this a bit yesterday. What is important is the singularity of your regularizer. Okay? To have good performance, you need regularizers that are convex but non-smooth. Okay, and tomorrow I will speak about how to actually compute this in practice. So today is theory, and tomorrow is more numerics and algorithm. All right, so this I already said a bit about this yesterday, so I will be also quite fast. So a traditional way to pose this problem is to think about linear subspaces, to have a collection, a huge collection of subspaces. So I spoke a lot yesterday about this idea of sparsity, sparse regularization, where the subspaces are vectors that are sparse, so with a lot of zeros, and corresponds to low-dimensional subspaces that are aligned with the axis. For instance, this one corresponds to one sparse set of vectors because it's aligned with one of the axis. And this plane corresponds to two sparse vectors, so it's a two-dimensional space. So this is plane sparsity, but then you can do some game of building more complicated and more efficient regularizer. So this corresponds to having models that are, for instance, having some kind of structure, so you group coefficient by blocks, which is equivalent to removing some of the subspace because they don't correspond to sparsity that occurs in blocks. And I've already said this, but this is very efficient in practice. So it's definitely something that is better than plane sparsity for natural images. Okay, and you can also play a game of computing sparsity over a transformed domain. So very classical model is the so-called total variation model that corresponds to piecewise constant images. So this is just a schematic view, but you have to imagine this in a 1 million dimensional space if you have 1 million pixels. Okay, and you consider discrete vectors that are constant on different areas, and this corresponds to various linear spaces. So each time, in some sense, you change the edge, the discontinuity set, you move from one subspace to another. So you can see here it's become very dense. You have a lot of subspace, very complicated. And you can even design priors that have an infinite number of subspace. Okay, so a continuum set of subspaces that generate manifolds. And something that is very popular, I would say, from 3 to 4 years ago, especially in machine learning, is this idea of having data that are designed and ordered as matrices, and then considering the fact that the data is going to be low rank. Okay? This is a typical example of you consider 2x2 matrices that are symmetric, so it's a 3D set. And this double cone is a set of rank one matrices. Okay, and the rays, each time you have a rays in this cone, it corresponds to one of the linear subspace. Okay? So all this encodes in some sense the notion of simplicity, of low complexity, okay, because you want your subspace to be low dimension. You want to have a small dimensionality, a small sparsity if you want. Here you want to have a few high gradients, so you want to have images that are cartoon and that have low perimeter in some sense. And here you want to have sparsity of the eigenvalues. Okay, you want to have most eigenvalue of your matrix that are zero. Okay? So what is the problem with this approach that is traditional in statistics, for instance, in model selection, is that it's combinatorial in nature. You have a huge collection or even an infinite collection of subspaces. So it's totally impossible to scan all the subspaces and test for the one you prefer, the one that minimizes your functional. So you need to come up with proxies. Okay? And here I will focus on convex proxies. Okay? In some sense, I want to convexify this model. Okay? I want to find some convex function. And the idea is that the singularity of this convex function will encode these subspaces. So each time you have a singularity, it will encode some subspace. And the dimension of the singularity will give you the dimension of the subspace. This is really simple, okay? And I want to make this a little bit more precise mathematically. And then I want to prove some theorem about, what are the performance, what are the stability you can achieve with this method. Because remember, you need to fight against noise. Very important to be robust to noise. Okay, so this would be geometric because I want to understand really the geometry of this function. Okay, so to simplify notation and also to simplify a bit the exposition, but you could be a bit more general than this, I will focus on convex regularizers that are also homogeneous. So it means J of alpha x is alpha J of x for alpha positive. Okay, so this will simplify a lot the explanation, and it's most of the time you actually have these properties. Okay, in fact, you can assume arbitrary homogeneity, but one homogeneity is simple to deal with. So this means it's almost like a norm, okay? Except it doesn't need to be symmetric. I don't impose symmetry. Although most of the time it's symmetric, but sometimes probably you can prefer positive values. So you could make something non-symmetric for image, because sometimes if you do astrophysics, the image cannot be negative. And also this function doesn't need to be positive. It can have a kernel. You could have g of x that is zero. Also, x doesn't need to be zero. If you think about total variation, so the L1 norm of the gradient, if you have a constant image, whatever the value of the constant can be very large, it's always giving you a total variation of zero. Okay, so it's not a norm because it's not symmetric and it can have the kernel, but otherwise it looks like a norm. So in particular, we can focus on its ball. Okay, it's called a gauge function. And gauge, in fact, they are in bijection with their unit ball. So each time you have a gauge, you can display its unit ball. Okay. And the converse is true. If you have a unit ball with zero in its interior, you have a unique gauge that corresponds to it. So it's useful because it allows me to make picture. I think it's simpler to display balls than function. Okay? And you will see it gives you some insight about what is actually happening by simply displaying the ball in 3D. Okay? So I want to display some typical example. So yesterday we have described this idea of L1 minimization as a proxy for sparsity. So this is typical L1 ball for, I would say, an image with 3 pixels, if you want. But imagine this in a very high-dimensional space. And it's obvious that here, the vertices of the L1 ball, which is this kind of crystal, so it's a polytop, will encode a one sparse signal. Okay? The intuition, if you want, so if you have a signal that is here, if you add a little bit of noise in your observation, probably this ball will inflate a little bit. Okay? And you see can only, here, translate in a 1D axis. In some sense, the solution to your optimization problem will be locked by this singularity on a 1D axis that exactly corresponds to one sparse signal. Okay, then if you have a little bit, you are a little bit less sparse, okay, this will correspond to X that will live on an edge. Okay, and also here it's obvious, if you think a bit in 3D, that this point will be allowed to translate on a two-dimensional space, because it can also translate along the singularity. Okay? So this x here has 2 degrees of freedom, so which will correspond to so all the edge here in this polytop will encode planes of dimension 2, so corresponds to vectors that are too sparse. Okay? So if I go back a little bit to this, okay, you can see that this is exactly matching the dimension of the singularity that you have here. So in some sense, it's another way to think of L1 as being a good proxy of the, what I called yesterday the L0 pseudonorm. Okay, you can even show that it's actually the best proxy in some sense. It's the convex hull, if you want. It's a lower convex envelope. And for sparsity, it's what most people do. Okay. Now, if you want to do group sparsity, so you want to allow only vectors that are sparse in groups, so the traditional way to do this is to use a mixed norm. So people do call this L1, L2 norm, for instance. So what you do, so here we are in 3D. So we leave the first coefficient alone, okay, and then we group coefficients 2 and 3, okay, which means, in fact, I use this norm, so the absolute value of x1 plus square root of x2 square plus x3 square. Okay, so these two guys here, these two coefficients, they will be grouped together, they will be locked together, okay, because you use the L2 norm and you don't separate them into absolute value. So it's a classical way to do what people call group sparsity, group lasso. And what is the effect of this on the shape? Okay, then you are not anymore a polytope. Okay, you see that you somehow smooth the singularities that are on the horizontal plane. Okay, so you erase in fact some of the vertices. Okay, by using this L2 norm, which is exactly what you want. Okay, I've said that group sparsity is a way to somehow kill some of the subspace. You remove subspaces that you think that are not important by grouping coefficients together. And of course, it's a good idea if it's true that your image actually have some kind of group structure. So for wavelet, it's very useful because you know that wavelet coefficients, they love to be grouped together because of edge and because of texture and so on. Okay? And you see, you don't have anymore a polytope. You have some kind of smooth, piecewise smooth manifold. So here, it's really the idea is designing balls that are piecewise smooth. Okay? I spoke a lot about this idea of the rank minimization, of trying to have data, so matrices that have a low rank. Okay, so what is the natural proxy, in some sense, the convex hull of the rank? In fact, it's quite natural. It's to say, okay, you want sparsity of the singular value, so you will just compute the L1 norm of the singular value. Okay, which means, mathematically, you simply decompose your matrix with the SVD. So it depends on x, so you have the singular value in sandwich here. And you consider this norm that sometimes it's called the nuclear norm or the trace norm, because it's a trace when it's positive matrix, which is the L1 norm of lambda. Okay, so it's a special case of a family of norms that are called spectral norms. And what is the geometry actually of this norm? So if you display the ball, so once again I consider symmetric 2x2 matrices. So I consider that my x here can be written as a, b along the diagonal, and C of diagonal, so it's a 3D plot in the ABC axis. And it's going to be a cylinder if you do the computation. Okay. And in fact, here you can also connect this to this double cone that I displayed before, because the singularity of this cylinder will exactly encode one-dimensional subspace that span rank one matrices. So the singularity of the cylinder are exactly rank one matrices having a unit norm, L1 norm for the singular value. So this is very, very, very easy to see. But of course, in higher dimension, this shape becomes very complicated. It's a union of complicated smooth manifold. Okay. And it's not the end of the story. Of course, you can design a lot of gauge function. For instance, something that is absolutely not useful in image processing, but people are using it nowadays to do a quantization to retrieve values in database. So they want to compute signatures that are binary. So in some sense, you want signatures that are anti-sparse, that are really full. And for this, you use the dual, the polar, to the L1 polytope, which is, of course, going to be the L-infinity norm. So the infinity norm is, in some sense, a way to encode subspace of anti-sparse vectors, so vectors that are very flat. Okay, and you can do the same trick and see what are going to be the T-subspace. So for now, it's just heuristic, and I will explain to you after how it's actually defined, but it's intuitive that you will have totally different subspace as those that you have with the L1 norm. Okay? So, as I said, for now it looks a bit like heuristics. How to derive this, it looks a bit fancy. But for instance, you could do summation of priors. Okay, you could say, I have a matrix that is both low rank and sparse. Okay, you can think about using the gauge function, which is the sum of these two guys. And it creates a new gauge, okay, to encode vectors that are both sparse and having low rank. For some application, it actually makes a lot of sense. Okay, so how can you make this a little bit more precise? How can you have this dictionary that if you give me a gauge function, I can tell you what are going to be the models that you consider? besides doing some graphics and heuristics. And the root here is to use convex analysis and in particular subdifferential calculus. Okay, because since the function is not smooth, you cannot compute its derivative, and the replacement for it is going to be the subdifferential. Okay, and it's very intuitive, and it's easy to see what it's going to be on the absolute value. Absolute value is a good prototype for a non-smooth function. Okay, and the subdifferential is just the set of lines that you can put below your curve. Okay, it's the slope of all the tangents that you can put below. Okay, so of course, if you are on the left of the singularity, then you have just one slope, which is minus one, which matches the derivative. So the subdifferential at a point when the function is actually smooth is equal to the derivative itself. Okay, on the right, it's going to be plus one. But if you are exactly on the kink, then you can see that you have the whole range between minus one and plus one of slope. Okay, so in general, the subdifferential is going to be a convex set of value. Okay, and in some sense, the larger is going to be the subdifferential, the more non-smooth is going to be your function. Okay, so in some sense, you have more sparsity, for instance, for L1, and then you have a subdifferential that is larger. Okay, so it looks a bit weird, but it's actually there is a canonical way to extend differentiable calculus to non-smooth function, and you have a lot of rules. For instance, you have some kind of chain rules for subdifferential. It's very useful to do computation and to compute for very concrete function their subdifferential. Okay, so typical example is the L1 norm, and it's very friendly because the L1 norm is a separable function. It's a sum of absolute value. So the subdifferential is just going to be the product of the subdifferential of the absolute value along each axis. Okay, so this is a typical display of this L1 ball. If you take this vector x, which is one sparse, what is going to be its subdifferential? So you look at its first coordinate, which is positive, which means its subdifferential is located here at plus one. But if you look at its second coordinate, it's zero, which means along the second axis, the vertical axis, the subdifferential is the whole interval. Okay, so you see that here the subdifferential at this point is this little segment. So it's not a point because the absolute value has a kink, so the L1 norm has a kink at this vector. And its shape, its size, control how much it's non-smooth. Okay, if you were to pick the zero point, okay, then it's zero on both axes and the subdifferential is a square. Is the L infinity ball. So at zero, you are really really highly non-smooth, even more than at this point. So the subdifferential is a bit bigger. Okay, so here you begin to feel, I think, what is going to be the link. So you really need to control sometimes the size of this different subdifferential. Okay, so for L1, this is another way to state this. It's very important to know the support. So the support is really what matters. Actually, the support and the sign is controlling everything for L1. Okay, the set of zero coefficients. So and non-zero coefficient here, the support, is what matters for L1. Okay, so now I will introduce just two notations, very important for later. The first one is this famous model. What is going to be the T value, the T space? So you are at a space X, and intuitively you want to pick a model that is the smallest possible that contain this X, and I denote this as T of X. And it's a definition, and you will see that it actually matches exactly this notion of sparsity. T of X, okay, how do you compute it? So first you take the affine hull of the subdifferential, which is going to be this red line here. So it's the smallest affine space that contains the subdifferential. Okay? And the model, the T, is going to be the orthogonal to this space. Okay? And it's easy to see that X always belongs to its model. So X is always a member of T of X. Okay? But T of X can be larger. So here you see it's just this blue line, which is a set of one sparse vector actually. Okay, so for L1, you can easily show that T of X is composed of all the vectors that have the same sparsity pattern, so the same support as your input vector. Locally, it's the space that you want to promote, if you want. Okay, so this is for the model, the T of X. It's very important for later to keep track of this notation. And the other one that I will use is this little e, and it's a way to write actually the equation of the red hyperplane. Okay, and I will use it a lot for later. Okay, so E is just the projection of zero on the affine hull. Okay, another way to state this is that if you pick any point in the subdifferential, it's actually equivalent to say this, if you project it onto your model, you become E. Okay, so any eta in the subdifferential is projected on your model on E. And this is a linear affine equation. This is just the affine equation of the red hyperplane. So it's going to be very useful for later. Because when I want to speak about the affine plane spanned by the subdifferential, I will just try this affine equation. Okay? So remember for later, it will be useful. T is the orthogonal of the subdifferential, and E is what's the vector that points at the subdifferential, so it's actually the projection of zero on the affine hull. Okay, so for L1, what does it give? So T is a set of sparse signal, and E is the sine vector. So it's minus 1, 0, or plus 1. Okay, so sometimes in the literature, it's often called the generalized sine. Everybody loves L1, so pick L1 as a typical example, but in practice, it doesn't need to be the sine always. So let me give some concrete example, to really show that it actually really matches the intuition that you have. So for sparsity, it gives you, of course, what I've already said. For group sparsity, so T is the same, of course, because group sparsity promotes sparsity, so T is going to be the set of sparse signal. But what is interesting is that the E vector is not anymore a binary vector. Okay, and it's linked to the fact that this shape here is not anymore a polytope. Okay, it has some curvature, so the E vector will allow to rotate a little bit. Okay, so how do you compute it? It's easy. You take an A, any vector, so you look at your different blocks, so this J function, block sparsity, is going to be the sum of L2 norms. Okay, and on each block, you look, either this block is zero, so in this case, the subdifferential is a disk, or it's non-zero, and it's going to be the E vector, which is just the value on this block divided by its norm. Okay, so of course, if you come back to the setting where blocks have size 1, so structure sparsity is equal to sparsity, it's just the L1 norm, then of course, this equation, A divided by absolute value of A, you go back to the sign. Okay, so it's a kind of a generalization of the sign for a vector that is not a 1D value. Okay, and this brings a lot of novelty. I mean, it's what makes the analysis of this setting a little bit more exciting, because you have this degree of freedom. The E vector is not constant, so the proof is more intricate. Okay, for the nuclear norm, for the convexification of small rank vector, you can do the computation. It's a bit more ugly. But you can prove that the E vector, it's also a generalization of this guy, actually. Because if you take a diagonal matrix, of course, this norm is equal to this guy. It's also some kind of generalization of the sign. It's just the outer product of the left and the right singular vector. Okay. And then the T space, it's a bit tricky because it's going to be spanned by sum of two matrices. One that has the correct left singular vector, and the other one that has the correct right singular vector. Okay, so of course you can move a little bit A and a little bit B to move away from X. Okay, and you can show that this is going to be the model actually that you promote if you have in your head this idea of nuclear norm. Okay, and if you are in 2D, it's going to be rank one matrices, but it's more general. It can cope with arbitrary rank, of course. And if you consider, for instance, the L infinity norm, you can also compute this, and the T vector is going to match the intuition, the T model, is going to be the set of vectors that are saturating at the same location as your X. Okay, so locally, you promote vectors that are saturating a lot, so it's good. It's exactly what you want when you do this idea of anti-sparsity, if you want. And you can do also the computation of the E, which is some kind of also normalized sine vector. Okay? So it's not always obvious, but you can carry the computation, and for your favorite functional, have this dictionary. Okay. I mean, if you have a question, feel free to interrupt me. It's just a few examples. Okay. And now that I have set up all the notation, so mainly I have a gauge function, J. I have its associated set of models, T, that are orthogonal to the subdifferential. And I have this generalized sign. Then I have all I need, all the ingredients to understand, quite deeply the performance of regularization. So first I will study L2 stability. I think it's the simplest question. And the theorem is actually, I would say, it's not trivial, but it's not very hard to prove. So it's a theorem of stability. Okay. So to study stability, first let's guess what you want to prove and to guess the hypothesis of the theorem, let's study the problem when there is no noise. Okay? So when there is no noise, I have already said this, it's pretty intuitive how to compute the computation. So you want to solve this constraint problem, because there is no noise. Okay, so what you do is you start by a small ball. So here I take the example of L1, but pick your favorite convex set, and you inflate it, okay, until the ball is going to touch the constraint. And of course, at this point, you have your minimizer. Okay. So in general, you're happy, but you want to be able to check whether x star is equal to x zero. Okay, and there is a very simple way to do this. In smooth convex analysis, it's called Lagrange multiplier. Okay, so it's just a generalization of Lagrange multiplier to the setting where it's non-smooth. Okay, it's like a tautology, if you want. I mean, it's really not really a complicated way to do this. And you say that this guy is going to be a solution of this problem if and only if there exists a dual multiplier, a Lagrange multiplier, eta, that needs to be multiplier for the constraints. So it needs to be orthogonal to the constraints. Then it's easy because this constraint is just an affine plane. So you need to be orthogonal to the range of phi, to the kernel of phi, sorry. So you see this set of vectors is parallel to the kernel of phi. Okay. So this is this first set here. You need to be in the range of phi star, so the orthogonal of the kernel. So it's going to be orthogonal like this to the constraints. And of course, you need to be a local minimizer of J. So you need, in some sense, to vanish the derivative. But since here you're non-smooth, you need to replace this by the subdifferential. Okay. So you need to find what I call a certificate eta. I call a dual certificate because it's called it's related to Lagrange or Rockefeller duality. That needs to be in the intersection of the range of phi star. So for instance, if you do deconvolution, you need to be smooth, you need to be convolved. Okay, so you need to be in the range of phi star. And at the same time, inside the subdifferential at x0. Well, I'm not saying it's easier. It's not easy. It's not easier to exhibit such eta than actually solving the initial problem. But you will see it's something that then you can massage a little bit to understand what's going to happen when you have noise. Okay. So what is the problem? The problem is, in general, it will work fine because if you have a little bit of noise, okay, then the green plane will rotate a little bit. Okay. But it's easy to see that okay, you can keep track of this rotation and move a little bit the red vector, and oops, whoa, rotate a little bit this red vector and exhibit a new dual certificate. Okay, the only problem that you will have is this: if this green plane has a 45 degree. Okay, if you have a 45 degree, first of all, you don't have a unique solution. Okay, you could say I don't really care, but you will have a problem because you will not always be able to exhibit a new dual certificate. So in fact, and this is just for 2D, so you need to understand what is going to be the ILPO situation, the problematic vector. Okay. And it's, okay, skip this, it's just the proof of this. This set of vectors that you want to avoid is just the boundary of the subdifferential. Okay. So what you want, and I call this a tight dual certificate, is to have a little bit more than just a dual certificate. You want something, someone, that is strictly inside the subdifferential. Okay, so in 2D, it's very intuitive. You need to remove these two extreme points, and then the grid line cannot have 45 degrees, so you're happy. Okay? But more generally, in higher dimension, you need to use what is called the relative interior. Okay? The relative interior is the interior for the affine topology of the subdifferential. When you do convex analysis, you never speak about interior. You always speak about relative interior. Okay? And you need to exclude this situation. Okay? And intuitively, the more your certificate is inside the subdifferential, the better you are, the more stable you are. Okay? And you can actually quantify this. Okay? So this is exactly the meaning of this theorem. So it's a general theorem that we proved with Gerald Fadili and my PhD student Samuel Bater, that shows that it's exactly matching the intuition. If there exists a certificate that is not on the boundary, then you're going to do good. So of course, when there is no noise, you make no error, because a tight certificate is a certificate, so you apply the previous theorem. But what is more interesting is that when you have noise, you have a solution, okay, that is not too far, and not too far means that you have an error that is proportional to the noise level. Okay, so this kind of result is exactly what people like in inverse problem community. It's called linear convergence rate. It means that you control the L2 error that you make by the L2 error of the noise. Okay, and as you can see, there's a lot of constant involved. First of all, for this to happen, you need to select lambda proportionally to the noise level. Okay, it's intuitive. If you have more noise, you need lambda, you need the penalization to be stronger. Okay, and this equivalence, I mean, if you check in the proof, you can actually keep track of the constant. It's an ugly formula, but you can keep track. And here also, the stability constant here is also, you can track this. And it's linked to how much you are close to the boundary. Okay, so if you can quantify how much you are close to the boundary, you can actually keep track exactly of the constant. Okay? So first of all, let me say that it's really lot of people have worked on this problem. It's a fundamental problem in inverse problem. Okay, you can see this as trying to measure the Lipschitz constant of X star. Okay, when there is no noise, you have exactly X0. And when you have a bit noise, you want to understand, is it Lipschitz? And if it's true, what is the Lipschitz constant? Okay, and this is a study for a lot of work. The first paper that really did this for L1, it's a landmark paper by the team of Otmar Scherzer, so it's the German school of inverse problem, that studied in depth the case of L1. And you see, it's relatively new. I mean, it's surprising that it was not proved earlier. It's a few years ago, a very interesting paper. Then there was another paper of his student, Grassmer, that studied this for a general setting, the same as we did, except that he has the proof of stability only by measuring the distance in terms of the J function. Okay, and it's very different to control the J function than to control the L2 norm. So in fact, our theorem is actually working with the L2 norm. For instance, the J function can have a kernel, if you think about total variation. So it's totally different to control the total variation, so to control the derivative of your image, than to control the image itself. We say, of course, I think it's much better to have this kind of scaling here. Something that also is important to realize is that here everything is finite dimensional. Okay? The constant involved are going to be function of the dimension of your problems. And it's totally non-trivial to extend this when n tends to infinity. So something important, and I will, if I have time, which I'm not sure, but I will discuss later, is what happens when your image has a number of pixels that tends to infinity. It's very, very important because in practice you have billions of pixels. So you could argue that you are closer to infinity than to actually something that is low dimensional. But here, really, the theorem doesn't go to in general, it doesn't go. And there is, I mean, obvious cases where it will not go. And something also I want to discuss is it any useful? I mean, because you make this theorem, you're happy, but then how can you check this hypothesis? It's really not obvious. If you give me a concrete problem with your favorite image, I'm not even sure I can check if it's true, because coming with this eta is not at all obvious. If you see the definition, it's a big set, you are in a high dimension. So I would say it's more a conceptual result than something that is actually useful to understand what will happen in concrete case. Okay? Which motivates what I will do in the remaining part. I will focus on something a bit more precise than simply L2 stability. I will focus on model stability, which means I don't want only L2 error to be small. I want, if I do sparsity, to recover exactly the good position. If I want to do astrophysical imaging, maybe I don't really care about having good L2 norm. I want to locate precisely the stars. If I do medical image, I want to detect sources in the brain. L2 error might not be very suited for medical application, but rather it's a source localization. And you will see that this is not only it's good for a lot of reasons, because probably it's a better error measure, but also because this will lead you to an explicit certificate. Okay, so the message is, if you look for something a bit more constrained than L2 stability, then you need to find a more specific dual certificate. Okay, so I will try to make this more precise. So let me illustrate first this theorem. So there is a setup, actually, that is well understood, where you can carry on the answer to this question. So when is it true that there exists a tight dual certificate? It's the compressed sensing setup. It's the setup where your matrix is random. But more precisely here, it's when it's Gaussian. So each entry is drawn independently at random with a Gaussian value. In this case, there is a few theorems. The first one is a wonderful paper by Rudelson and Vershinin. Okay, and more recently, a paper from a team at MIT of Parillo and co-author that did exactly the computation of when is it true that you have a tight dual certificate. And you can show that it's true. So you have a random matrix that takes p measurements. Okay, if p is a little bit larger than the sparsity. So you have a vector of complexity s. So of course, if the vector is more complex, you can say, obviously, you need more measurements. And it's really a very good result because it's very tight. You can show that if p is larger than two times the sparsity multiplied by log n divided by s, then I can apply the previous theorem, which means if there is no noise, I reconstruct exactly my signal by L1. And if there is noise, I have stability. Okay. So, and you can actually show that this is tight. And I will come back to this in the second slide. Meaning if this condition is broken, then you can show that actually you will not succeed. It's a phenomenon that is called phase transition, and I will come back to this. So it's really a binary choice. Okay, you pick a vector, either you have enough measurement and you will do perfect recovery, either you have not enough measurement and you will do crappy recovery. And this is a randomized theorem because you have to notice that it's a theorem that holds with high probability on the matrix. And you can control the, so what does it mean, high probability? It means the probability tends to one very fast, so exponentially fast with the dimension. Okay, so this is not cheating, it's really something that is very close to one as soon as the dimension is a few thousand. Okay, but still there is a bit of probability here. Okay, the second theorem, it's exactly the same, but if you switch from sparse vector to low rank matrices. So if you have a matrices that have rank R, then the number of measurements you need clearly matches the intuition. It needs to be larger, slightly larger than the complexity of a low rank matrix. So a low rank matrix is parametrized by U, lambda, and V. It's roughly R times N and R times N, if you want information values. And it's exactly this. If you have 3 times R times the sum of the dimension as a small, here, minus R, then you will do a good, meaning you will recover exactly when there is no noise and with stability when there is noise. And this is actually just applying the previous theorem. Okay? So you can show similar results for group sparsity. So you can carry on the exact computation, also for L-infinity norm. But unfortunately, this line of method only works for very simple J function. So it's an open problem to solve this for. You pick your favorite convex function. It's totally unclear how to have such a very good bound. Okay, and there is even, so this is very recent results, it's two years ago. And actually this year, so a few months ago, there is a paper from the team of Joel Tropp at Caltech that actually computed in closed form the exact curve of phase transition. This is for L1 and this is for nuclear norm. And people in compressed sensing, they love this kind of display. Okay, so on the horizontal axis, you have the complexity of your signal. So zero, it means it's zero vector, it's very sparse. And as you get closer to one, then the sparsity becomes larger and larger. So here you are highly non-sparse, and here you are sparse. And here it's the number of measurements. So the more you are on the top, the more measurements you have, so the better it should be. And then you display in gray value the probability that a vector is recovered. So of course, you can never compute exactly this probability, so it's a display that is computed by Monte Carlo. Okay, and you really see this phase transition, meaning that you have a sharp transition between you recover everybody and here you recover nobody. Okay, and you can actually exactly compute this phase transition. Okay, and this equation that I gave before, so this equation which is that the phase transition is 2s times log n divided by s, is in fact just the asymptotic in this region. Okay, so in this region you have a very simple formula, it's 2s times log n divided by s. And exactly the same happens for a nuclear norm. You have here the formula that you can write very easily. And more generally, you have some kind of implicit equation of this phase transition. So it's really beautiful, but once again, it's only for the simple case where you have Gaussian matrices. Okay? Okay? But it's a good illustration of the previous theorem. What can you do if you have either non-random matrices or you are not with L1 or something more complicated? Then you can focus on this idea of trying to assess exact model stability, so recover exactly the T space, not only having small two error, but small L2 error, but localizing precisely, for instance, the position of your Dirac's. And what we found with my students is that it's actually related to picking a specific dual certificate. Okay, and it's something that was in the literature for more than, I mean, I would say dead bait to early work of Jean-Jacques Fuchs in Henri Arène in 2004, but it was not written like this. So it took up some time to really discover the structure of this. The idea is, okay, what does it mean to be a dual certificate? Okay. It means that eta should be some kind of phi star of Q, so in the range of phi star, so orthogonal to the constraints. And you need to be in the subdifferential. Okay? And in fact, here I will do some kind of a guess, a non-zatz. Okay? I say I replace this a bit complex constraint by its affine hull. So I just write the affine equation of the subdifferential. So if you remember, it was in the first slide of this talk, the equation of the affine hull of the subdifferential is just that it's the set of eta. And when it gets projected onto the model, it's equal to E. Okay, so this is an affine constraint. So of course, it's not if and only if. Okay, there are a lot of vectors that satisfy these two constraints that are not dual certificates. It's just an implication because you remove some of the constraints. Okay, so what you will do as a onsatz, you will pick the one that has the smallest L2 norm. Because in some sense, if you have a small L2 norm, there is a lot of change that you are inside the subdifferential. For now, it's like a heuristic, nothing really theoretical here. So you pick the one that among all the vectors that can be written as a phi star of Q, so that are in the range of phi star, and at the same time agree with the affine equation of the subdifferential as the smallest L2 norm. And why this is very good, because besides the fact that it's maybe a good heuristic, is that this is just a quadratic minimization with affine constraints. So you can actually compute in closed form by simply doing, it's a least square, it's just a least square solution to this system of equation. So you just can compute the solution by the pseudo-inverse, or by using conjugate gradient, if you prefer. Which means this guy that I denominate as eta zero, if you give me your favorite signal, I can compute it. Okay. And if I'm a bit clever, I could do probably a bit of math to analyze it. Okay. So this is just the equation. It looks a bit weird, but it's just the pseudo-inverse of this linear system here. Okay. So what is the theorem, which is here is truly theoretical results, okay, is that if this guy, eta zero, which is a good guess, so sometimes I call this a pre-certificate, is actually a certificate, so if it actually matches the interior of the subdifferential, okay, so first of all, you could apply the previous theorem, so you know that you are stable, that you have L2 stability, but in fact, you know much more, because you know that you recover exactly the Goop subspace. So if I were to use L1, this theorem, so I can compute this, tell me that if this guy is strictly inside the subdifferential, and being strictly inside the subdifferential for L1, it means having a L infinity norm strictly smaller than 1. So if this guy is strictly smaller than 1 in absolute value, then not only I have L2 stability, which is well known, and it's from the work of Jean-Jacques Fuchs, as I said, but you also recover exactly the sparsity structure. So you recover exactly the good position. Okay. Well, maybe I should pause for a second because I'm giving you a lot of information here. But it's really, if you want, you put more constraints as before. Before you were saying, I allow myself for an arbitrary dual certificate. Okay. Here I just say, okay, let's pick this one and let's check whether it's actually true that it's a dual certificate. So of course the hypothesis is stronger, but since the hypothesis is stronger, you gain a lot because you have also stronger conclusion. Okay, there's no free lunch. Of course, in general, this theorem will apply not as often as the previous one. Okay, there's obviously signals that are stable in L2, but that are not stable according to the model selection. Yes, so it's also, so maybe it's exactly what I wanted to emphasize on, is that also the good thing, not only the theorem tells you more, is the hypothesis is also very easy to check. It's just solving a linear system and then checking whether in L1 it's smaller than one in absolute value. So the hypothesis is not like some abstract thing that there exists. Here in this theorem, there's no there exists. It's just you give me your favorite signal, and I can check whether it's going to be stably recovered with this bonus here. So it's also, and it's a reason why this theorem was actually used a lot in compressed sensing, in the early days of compressed sensing, because this gives checks that are super easy to do. It's like four lines proof with respect to the previous theorem, which just dates from actually a few months. So it's a technology that it's actually simpler to apply for real-life problem. Okay. So as I say, it's not new. First, it was done by Jean-Jacques Fuchs in the early days. Then there was several work of Francis Back, and most notably on the nuclear norm. It was not exactly state like this, but if you look inside this proof, it's actually the heart of his statistical analysis is this theorem. Okay. And what we did with our student is we just say, okay, it's actually working for any gauge function. Which is not so trivial because for L1, the proof is actually relying on the polytop structure of L1, whether here it's a bit more tricky because the gauge can be arbitrary. Okay. If you have questions, might be a good... otherwise, I want to illustrate this theorem now. Okay. I want to show a few illustrations before I finish the talk, if I have time. Yes. You can stop me if I'm too late. The first one is on compressed sensing. Let's take the exact simple compressed sensing setup as before. And let's now try to check whether it's true that the minimum norm certificate, pre-certificate, is a certificate. So this is something that we did with Charles Dossal in Bordeaux a few years ago. And there was a previous work quite similar by Martin Renright a few years before. You can actually show that it's true that eta zero is a certificate if p is larger than 2s log n. So if p is larger than 2s log n, so you have similarly, you have a bit more measures than the intrinsic information of your signal, then you can apply the previous theorem. Okay, so let me compare the two theorems. So the first one was L2 stability, so there exists an arbitrary dual certificate. Here is model stability, so exact some people call this sparsity. So you want to recover the sparsity pattern. And you see it's almost the same, except instead of having log n divided by s, you have log n. So the phase transition is a bit less optimistic. You see, it's only a slight change, but this changes a lot, because the gap that is between the two is going to be vectors that you can stably recover in L2, but for which you never recover stably the position of the Dirac. And if you do the computation, you will recover always a little bit of spurious Diracs that pollutes the result, whether here you have exactly the good Dirac location. Okay. So you can do the similar computation for a few gauge function, L1, L2, so group sparsity, nuclear norm, L infinity, but same thing here. The analysis is simple, but it's only working for a very simple gauge function. So if you take me, you give me an arbitrary complicated function, I cannot really compute this phase transition here. Okay? And if people know a bit about compressed sensing, there was a huge hype at the beginning of compressed sensing that was using this ideas of restricted isometry property, that the phi mapping is locally an isometry. It's very different. So the analysis here is much, much finer. So I think this technique of proof is way better than what people did in early days of compressed sensing. Okay. So for those who don't know, okay, don't matter. You should really focus on this result. But I think people have now understood that you need to learn about convex analysis to have a really sharp result. Okay. So let me now give a more concrete and more, I would say, deterministic and probably more real-life application, which is a sparse spike deconvolution. So it's really the application that triggered all this L1 norm stuff and so. It was in the 80s, people in geoseismic for oil exploration that used first L1. Then David Nono, so his father was actually working in oil company, so I think he got interested in this idea, and then did the maths. Okay, and it was the idea of you send a wave pulse in the ground, okay, and then to first approximation, if you do some kind of linearization of the wave equation, what you get back is a convolution of a train of Diracs, so which in some sense locates the change of density in the ground, convolved by the wave you send in the ground. So what you want to find is this, and what you observe is this. So you want to go back from here to here. So what is missing is the high frequency, okay? It's called deconvolution. It's a very simple setup, but it's quite tricky to understand, and there is a lot of open problem on this question of when is it true that L1 is going to recover exactly these spikes, okay? And more importantly, when will this inversion be stable? Because as you can imagine, inverting this is super unstable. Okay, so it's a good question that we have been working a lot with my postdoc Vincent Duval recently. So what you can do, at least now, is you can do a grid. So you do a discretization here. So you turn this into a finite dimensional problem and you solve L1. Okay, and what you do is you apply the previous theorem. So you compute your pre-certificate, eta 0. It's an equation, you just compute it, it's easy. And then you check when is it true that this eta 0 is actually a certificate, which is exactly saying that when is it true that eta 0 is strictly smaller than 1 outside of the Dirac's. Okay, this is just the equation of I want to be in the relative interior, you need to have a strict inferior. Okay, and with respect to the question of André, if you are the quantity by how much you are smaller than 1 gives you the amount of stability you have. Okay, and here it's a display that what is happening as the Dirac get closer and closer. Okay, and you can see that when they are far away, you are much below 1, so you do good. And there is a threshold, and at some point, you are below some kind of Rayleigh diffraction limits, and they get mixed up, and you cannot deconvolve them. Okay, and you can actually try to prove what is going to be this value. So there was a work of Stéphane Mala and Charles Dossal that proved that this limit exists. And if you are after this limit, then you do good. You recover exactly the position. Okay, so maybe, so I think it's a good illustration, and then you can think about your favorite problem and try to do a similar analysis. Okay, if you work in medical imaging, you can think of what is going to be the phi operator and try to understand what is this limit that you can achieve with L1, and it's quite hard to actually try to prove this. Okay, and to finish this talk, I would like to study what happens when the grid, in some sense, gets smaller and smaller, because the intuition is, probably, okay, I'm not using a grid that is dense enough. Maybe if I use a grid that is finer, I could do a better job. And in fact, this intuition is totally wrong. Okay? Actually, when you use a grid that is too dense, you can show that it's not working. And this is exactly this observation. If you take a grid that is finer and finer, at some point, this criteria will break. So there is some points, okay, where if the grid is too dense, the previous theorem will never apply. Okay, and the reason is simple. It's just the fact that if the grid is too dense, the problem is so ill-posed that it's unsolvable. Okay, and the other reason is also intuitive. Is the previous theorem is asking you for the spike to stay exactly on its grid, on its position. But in fact, the spikes would like to move a little bit, probably. Okay. Because you're putting a grid structure, but it's totally arbitrary. Okay, so in fact, wanted to assess exact stability on a very, very dense grid is like a crazy thing to do. Okay, it's obvious that this is never going to work. I mean, it's obvious, but people do this every day, so you can ask why. So really, the natural setting where the grid comes denser and denser is just to remove the grid. And to stay, maybe you want to solve the problem without grid. Okay, and this just corresponds to saying, okay, instead of looking for sparse vectors, I want to look for measures, for Dirac's. I want to look for continuous settings. So I want to ask the question of recovering a stream of pulse of Dirac's. Okay? So if you do this, you need to replace the L1 norm. And it's pretty easy what you want to do. You want to take the extension of the L1 norm to measures. Okay? And this is called the total variation of a measure. Total variation of a measure, if the measure has a density, it's L1 norm. And if it's a sum of Dirac's, it's also well defined. It's just the L1 norm of the amplitude. Okay, so the total variation of a measure, which should not be confounded by the total variation of an image, okay, same word but two different stuff here, is just the L1 norm but extended to function that can be measured, so very localized. Okay, it's a natural setting and it's what people are trying to do now. There are a few papers appearing recently on this idea of trying to work in a grid-free setting. So what do you do now? I mean, you have measurements, okay, so for instance, the convolution, or actually an arbitrary operator, linear operator, that takes Radon measure and outputs some kind of measurements. You have also noise, of course, so it's exactly the same as before, except now you are in infinite dimension. You have no grid. Okay. So here, for the theorem that I will describe to hold, you need the operator to have a kernel that is smooth. So for instance, think about a convolution with a smooth kernel, a Gaussian kernel, for instance. Okay. And then you want to recover a discrete measure, a sum of Dirac's, by solving exactly the same as before, except you replace the L1 norm by the total variation of the measure. Okay, but now you need to solve an infinite dimensional program, which might be good for a mathematician, but for an engineer, how do you solve this? So I think it's something that is an active domain of research recently. There is a few guesses that you can do. Something that you can do is if the range of your operator has a finite dimension, in fact, you can compute what is called its dual problem, similar to the dual, so the Lagrange duality. And this is going to be a finite dimensional problem. So actually, it's really a typical case where it's easier to solve the dual problem than the primal one. Okay. And something that is also very friendly is that if phi is translation invariant, so if it's just basically a convolution, you can show that you can solve the primal problem using standard convex method. Actually, it's called SDP programming. So for some cases, I'm not saying all, but for some subcases, mainly deconvolution, you can actually solve this problem. It's an infinite dimensional problem, but you can solve its dual, and then you can compute the location of the Dirac exactly. It's kind of surprising, and it's really linked to the geometry of SDP program. Okay? And it's also working in 1D. In 2D, it's not clear how to do this. No. What is important here is you don't know nothing before. Except what you can say is if you have something, if the range of your operator have dimension p, for instance you do p Fourier measurements, then you can always show that this program will the solution to this program will always be sum of Dirac's with p measures, with p Dirac's. Okay. But you don't know its location. It's what is tricky. Okay? So it's really a convex program. Okay, so now let me try to finish this by showing in some sense the comparison with the previous setting. So this is the infinite dimensional setting. So you want to recover, for instance, these two Dirac's. There's no grid. Then what I did before is I put a grid. So I recasted in some grid program into a finite dimensional program on this grid. Okay. So this is a continuous program and this is a discrete program. Okay. So what I did before is I said, okay, let's compute this pre-certificate, this minimal norm certificate. And there is a nice way to actually do an intuition about what do you do when you want to compute this certificate. When you do L1, in fact, you're computing the best function in the range of these stars that interpolate the position of the Dirac. Okay. So in fact, you can show that this, I call this eta of F in the honor of Jean-Jacques Fuchs. So it's the precertificate associated to this result of Jean-Jacques Fuchs is going to be this shape here. And then it's intuitive why it will not work when the grid is too dense, because you see that you are always have some kind of overshooting here, either on the left or on the right. Okay, which means that if the grid is too dense, if the red points here are too dense, then you will have some value here that is above one. So the vector, the red curve, will not be a valid finite dimensional certificate. Okay, so what we did with my students is we understood that the good certificate is not this one, when you have no grid. The good certificate needs to have a little bit more constraints. You need not only to interpolate the sign pattern, you need also to have zero vanishing derivative. Okay, it's pretty intuitive that if you don't only interpolate here the sign, but also you ask for this interpolation to have vanishing derivatives, then there is much more chance that this blue curve will stay inside this little tube. Okay, so we call this the vanishing precertificate. It's still very easy to solve. You just need to solve a linear system, so you can compute it in practice. Okay, and then we have two theorems side by side. The first one is the finite dimensional one, which says, okay, if this guy, if the red guy here is friendly, if it's actually a valid certificate, then you will recover exactly the sign pattern on the discrete grid. But as I've shown you before, this guy, the red guy, will always fail if the grid is too dense. Now, when you switch to continuous, what is very interesting is you need to choose a different precertificate. You need to choose the blue one. And then you have almost the same theorem, except now there is no grid. So the theorem tells you that you recover exactly the same number of Dirac, except now they can move a little bit on the left and on the right. Okay, so because there is no grid, you allow yourself, you allow the position of the Dirac to vary a little bit. And as the noise tends to zero, you will see that this program recovers very accurately the position of the Dirac. Okay, so these settings really tell you exactly what's happening. As the noise gets smaller and smaller, this generalized L1 will recover the good Diracs with locations that converge to the initial one. So it's really something that I think in practice is much less pessimistic, and it gives you a much better picture of what is actually happening. Okay, and the last thing I want to mention is then we study what is the relation, so what's happening when the grid gets denser and denser. So I won't go into the details, but I mean, and this is just an example to show what's happening on a sinus cardinal filters. Okay, so it's just a zoom on the previous picture. So you see that when you interpolate to zero the derivative, you have something that is much more likely to stay more friendly below plus one, whereas the one that you just interpolate the value will always overshoot. Okay. And this is a theorem that we had, which is I think quite interesting, is that if the grid is dense, so I said okay, the Dirac is not stable on the discrete grid. So if you actually solve the finite dimensional program, you will not have exactly stability on the discrete grid. What will happen if the noise is small enough, so it's really something that works when the noise is not too large, you will actually find pairs of Dirac. Okay. Instead of finding just one Dirac if you solve your discrete program, or your continuous program, you will find a solution that is made of pairs of Diracs, which really match exactly what's happening in practice. So this is a display, so I have when there is no noise, I recover exactly with the discrete program the two values. So this is just a display of the value you recover as lambda increases. Okay? And immediately, if lambda is non-zero, or if you have a little bit of noise, you see that you have two spurious spikes that are growing. Okay? So on the discrete grid, it's only when there is no noise and when lambda is zero that you recover your data. If there is a little bit of noise, and if lambda is non-zero, you will find exactly four Diracs. And then if lambda is too large, and then the noise is too large, and everything becomes to be nasty. But in this range where the noise is not too large and lambda is small, you can really have a theorem that tells you what you will recover. Okay? And really explaining you, in some sense, the convergence between the discrete problem to the continuous one. It's going to be pairs of Dirac that get smaller, closer and closer, until there is no grid where you actually recover just one Dirac. Okay? So I think it's quite nice because it really connects the two settings. Okay? So let me conclude this talk, I mean the second lecture. The first idea, so there is a lot of ideas, so it was a bit dense, but the key idea, I think the first one is that when you want to regularize inverse problem with something that are a bit more general than sparsity, then the idea is to find a gauge function that are piecewise regular, that the singularity of the gauge are encoding the models, and you can actually give very precise meaning to this statement. The second one that we find with our students after, it's not always clear in the literature, but it's really what actually is driving the community, is depending on the performance measure that you want to use, so L2, model selection, or pick your favorite measure of performance, then this gives you different theorems. So for compressed sensing, you will have different asymptotics, of course. But also the analysis is driven by specific certificates. So if you are interested only in L2 stability, then it's clear you need to pick L0. Maybe if you have your own error measure, then you need to pick another one, I don't know. If you look for exact localization of the spike, then over a discrete grid, this is going to be this certificate. If you look for exact localization of the spikes but without grid, then this will be another one. Okay? So there is kind of a, I would say, some, you need to be a little bit trained to understand what is going to be the dual certificate that drives the error, and it's very important. And of course, it's opened the door for many, many research, I think. For the compressed sensing area, I think it's pretty open to analyze what's happening if you have more complicated priors than just sparsity or low rank. If you read, there is tons of paper on L1, tons of paper on low rank, but almost no paper on total variation, almost no paper on mixed models. So if you're sparse and low rank, what's happening? It's an open question. And also, more generally speaking, is to understand what's happening when you don't have exact model stability. And I think it's really important, especially if you want to go to infinite dimensional settings. Okay? As n tends to infinity, you have many, many models. They become closer and closer. So you need some notion of approximate stability of the model. And we did this for L1, which becomes then the measure regularization. But for other prior, it's pretty, I think it's a difficult question. And I think that's it. And thanks a lot.
Thank you, Gabriel. I want to know what are the big difficulties when you go to higher dimensions?
So you want to know the theoretical difficulty or the numerical difficulties?
Numerically.
So numerical, I think I will focus on this tomorrow. So it's really, as you can imagine, the algorithm becomes slower and slower. Okay. And basically, you need to devise algorithms that at each iteration doesn't cost too much with respect to the dimension. Okay, but this will be the focus of tomorrow's talk. So obviously it's slower when you have gigapixel images, but also you need to care about, I would say, new algorithm, because in the community of convex optimization, they really focus a lot on, for instance, anterior point method or algorithms that are very precise, that can achieve very fast, good precision, but they don't really care about how much does one iteration cost. And I think in image processing, so when you go to dimensions that exceed the millions or the billions, then you want algorithms that each iteration has linear cost, or maybe n log n is okay, but you cannot, definitely, you cannot invert a matrix at each step. Okay? So the paradigm for I think at least this kind of problems when you go to high dimension is a bit different from the traditional convergence analysis where okay, you are happy with Newton method because they converge in quadratic way, but Newton method is totally impossible to implement with in million dimension. Okay, so I don't know if it answers the question, but it's really hard if you have an algorithm that requires you to compute the Hessian of J or some kind of generalization. It's impossible. And then from a theoretical point of view, there is a lot of questions, as I said, that are open. Because as the dimension gets larger and larger, the model becomes more and more unstable. If you do deconvolution, you have a matrix that is so ill-posed that you cannot even, it's crazy, it gets really, really, really ill-posed. So you really need to think about other criteria than model stability. So I think it's really like open problems.
Can you use conditioning for matrices?
Could you say it again?
For theoretical reasons.
Yeah.
Well, for the theory, I can suggest using like preconditioning.
So it's more for numerical. So preconditioning, for instance, if you want to run, so it's a good question. It's a good point, and it's mostly open research to have some kind of preconditioning or it's called. It's a bit like doing conjugate gradient if you want. I will not speak of this tomorrow. And it's really difficult, especially when the problem is non-smooth. And from theoretical, I have absolutely no idea. So. But it's a very good question.
I've got a question about the first stability theorem.
Okay. Maybe I can come back to it.
So you mentioned that the Lipschitz constant depends on the distance
yes.
between eta and the boundary of...
Yes, exactly.
So I wonder, in when you take a typical example, for instance, L1,
yes.
what is the in radius of this d bar?
What is the
in radius, I mean, what is the diameter of this?
How so large it's exactly, I mean, then when you are, so when you do L1, okay, maybe, so when you, so for L1 you can carry, I mean, the theorem, it gets pretty simple for L1 and you can write down all the constants. So for L1, the subdifferential of L1 at a point x, okay, is a set of eta. So you need eta on the support to be interpolating the sign, and on the complementary of the support, it needs to be smaller than 1. Okay, so it typically needs to be smaller than 1 minus epsilon. Okay, so epsilon, no, so this is the guy, but so if you take the relative interior, then this guy needs to be smaller than 1 minus some epsilon, right? And the constant is exactly 1 over epsilon. I mean, it's scaling like 1 over epsilon.
Okay, so in that case, it doesn't depend on the dimension.
No, it depends. I mean,
okay,
it's going to be something like the conditioning of your matrix on I divided by epsilon. Like this. I mean, it's more complicated.
Okay.
It's like, I don't think it fits even in a one line of LaTeX, but it's like this. The scaling is, first it depends on how much your matrix is injective on your subspace. The numerator will always be the injectivity radius of your linear operator, and the denominator will be epsilon. And it's actually the general recipe for our proof. Except for L1, it's simpler because since it's a polytope, you have things that are much simpler.
So here you have a linear constraint, and you minimize something, a gauge that is not smooth.
Oui, yes.
Is there a situation where the constraint itself is something non-smooth, non-smooth convex?
Yes, yes, yes. So it's a bit tricky. Actually, it's not clear exactly. No, I think it extends to this. So in fact, if you have other constraints, for instance, you have positivity constraint or things like this, you can encode them in the gauge themselves by saying the gauge is as something that is plus infinity when the constraint is violated. Okay, and then you can apply this and compute the subdifferential of a convex function that jumps to plus infinity, basically.
Okay.
And I will speak about this tomorrow. It's a very natural way to write everything. All the constraints, you lift them in the
gauge.
Objective so that it stays nicely and so on. Positivity is just saying that you remove the remove this. You need for each j this guy to be smaller than 1, and it doesn't care about going negative. It's actually much simpler.
So for the continuous limit, the last
yes.
problem you mentioned,
yes.
Do you know of any work, or would it be relevant to iterate between an adaptive grid and
yes.
L1 machinery?
Yes, it's very good. I mean, so it's more for the numerical schemes. There is there is two papers that study this question of how to solve this program. In fact, this program is a convex function of the measure. It's also a convex function of the of the elevation of the Dirac. But of course, it's not a convex function of the horizontal of the grid. So what you can do is you can alternate between. You can alternate between solving this guy and then some kind of gradient descent on the position, and you can actually prove that it's converged to a solution. Okay. So it's something that I want to study is study some kind of algorithm that is like this. So it's kind of a bridge between something that is convex but infinite dimension and something that is non-convex but finite dimension. You see? And in practice, this is, of course, a much better way to proceed. So. Because I'm not telling you the whole story, but it's solving this problem by duality is quite involved. And it works only in 1D. So. And it's really linked to deep property of the SDP cone that can encode positive polynomials, so you put trigonometric polynomials. So this is really, I mean, I don't have the time to explain this, but I could make a whole lecture on this. It's very fascinating how to encode this.
I have a small question about the certificate, the existence of this ETA.
Yeah.
Do you think it's possible to incorporate this existence directly as a regularizer into the optimization function itself?
It's a good question. So maybe what you are suggesting is to derive a better regularizer that will have some
right.
nicer certificate.
Because if it's relatively simple to obtain it, then perhaps it's...
So I have no ideas. I mean, it looks like a good question and something that could be done. What we have been for now focusing is actually the numerical computation of the certificate,
right.
which itself is tricky. Because I'm not telling you exactly the shape. So basically what you would like is to have the better possible constant here. So first of all, you would like epsilon to be positive, but also you would like somehow to control these constants. And the certificate is involved both in the numerator and the denominator. So it's very tricky to understand the true impact of the certificate on the finite stability results. Okay. So it's possible, could be possible, but it leads to very complicated non-convex program just to optimize the certificate. Then to change the gauge looks complicated. I would say that probably the good way to proceed is to have some kind of clear understanding of how everything behaves, and then of course you can try to come up with a better regularization that is more stable. For instance, if you do deconvolution, probably you need to choose wisely the grid. It's just like this. I mean, to have a better chance to have stability on this grid. There is a threshold where the grid is too dense and you cannot have right. certificates.
And I also had another small, like maybe not very interesting question, is if you go back.
Okay.
Yeah, like a couple of slides before.
Okay.
To this next slide. This one, yeah. So there is a small dip, like after or before the red line.
Before here?
Yeah. No, yeah, on the left.
Yeah. Oh, no, on the left, yeah.
Yeah, it's not monotonous. Below one. Do you know why? I mean, because it goes above one?
Yeah, the reason is that this guy, so if you were to use a Gaussian kernel, then this would be monotonous. But because this guy has like this kind of oscillating shape, there is no way that this guy is monotonic. So you can prove that at some point it drops small enough. And it's quite hard actually to locate this. But there's no guarantee, I mean, you could have this kind of shape. And to really understand why it's hard, what you need is somehow concavity around zero, and then this guy here will make this guy oscillate a bit, but it's actually very tricky. I mean, analyzing this eta zero on the discrete grid is very, very hard, and it's much simpler to remove the grid. And there is a recent paper of Emmanuel Condes and his students that is not exactly using, so he's not using the certificate that we propose with my students, so he's not, where was it? Oops, sorry, it's after. So he's not studying this vanishing derivative. He's actually building his own certificate, which will not be a certificate for our theorem, but that he can actually do the proof and carry over. And he found that if you have a sinus cardinal, so which corresponds to ideal filtering, where you take all the Fourier frequencies between minus F and plus F, you can show that if the spikes are separated by more than 2 divided by F, which is the Rayleigh limit, then you can show that it works. And there is an open problem, an open question of what is actually the optimal constant, and the conjecture is that super resolution works up to the Rayleigh limit of 1 divided by the cutoff frequency. And I think it should be a very hard question to solve, but okay.
Thanks.